there everyone, welcome back to the Cerberus saga. In the previous episode, we've finished what could be achieved with the breadboard prototype. It was fully functional with the simple testing programs we've used. Of course, it's plagued by parasitics. We've managed to get it stable for those simple programs. The next step is, of course, to design the first full, complete custom PCB for Cerberus. And that's what we will discuss in this episode. The first step, of course, was to take all that work I did over the board over the past many weeks and capture that in proper schematics. So I'll start from that. The schematics for Cerberus has three pages. First page is here, is this video circuit that you see in front of you. It's largely the same design we've discussed ad nauseum in the first half of the series. Not much has changed. We still have caviar, we still have skunk, we still have the dual ported memories. There was one optimization I've done which improved the stability of the circuit even more. Remember, the key challenge here is these two CPLDs, the ATF-1508 and the ATF-1504, particularly the 1508 because of its function in this circuit. They are prone to instability during power-up. They have a power-up reset function. I would go as far as to say it doesn't work very well. I mean, it works according to specs, but the specs require that the VCC power signal rises monotonically in a very stable way, and that can be hard to achieve. So to get around that, we've discussed before, I had to use this little inverter here, which takes a bus or buffer enable signal from skunk. So this SBE stands for skunk bus enable. It is this pin here, pin 12 on skunk. And when skunk finishes powering up, then this pin will be logic value 1, it will be high. And once this is high, this transistor will close, and then the potential at this point here will become ground. Before SBE is high, the transistor is open, and because there is a pull-up here to VCC, this point will be high. So this point will only be low after skunk is fully powered up. So let's see what happens. When you turn the computer on, this point will be high, and it's connected to the output enables of the buffer, the first buffer, which provides the clock for skunk. And these output enables are active low, so this at power up will be high, so the buffer will not be enabled. So skunk will not get its clock signal during power up, which is exactly what we need, because in the datasheet and the application notes from Microchip, they tell you explicitly you cannot give the clock until the ATF-1508 is fully powered up. So this will take care of that, that the buffer is only enabled, and therefore the pixel clock signal here, PCLK, will only go through into boosted PCLK, which is the input here on pin 83 for skunk. It will only go through after skunk is fully powered up. Now, this we've discussed before. What is new here is that I'm picking the same signal here, I'm calling it skunk reset. I'm picking this same signal and wiring it into pin 1 of skunk. And skunk is programmed such that when pin 1 is high, all the internal flip-flops are reset, they're set to 0. And the idea is that during power up, again, this value will be high, remember? So during power up, the skunk reset signal will be active, and skunk will be in a reset mode until power up is done. Because at that point, SBU will be high, the transistor will close, and skunk reset will be low, and then it will stop resetting itself. So by adding this little signal here, wired into pin 1, I increase the robustness of the reset mechanism of this CPLD. This works like a charm, it works pretty well. On the original board I have been using as a prototype, it's also a custom board, I just needed to pass a bodge, almost invisible green bodge from the emitter of Q2 to pin 1 of skunk, and that does the job. But of course in the final version of Cerberus there will be no bodges. This will be taken into account into the custom PCB itself. The rest is what you've seen before. I finally settled here on the bottom right for a switch mode regulator or a DC to DC converter or a buck converter, whatever you want to call it, instead of a linear regulator. I was a little bit afraid of the switch mode regulators because, again, these CPLDs require monotonic increase of VCC, and I was afraid that these switch mode devices could add some ripples to the VCC rise and break the monotonicity, and then the CPLD wouldn't reset properly during power on. But I figured that with these things that I've done here, that I just talked about, it works fine even with the switch mode regulator, and these things don't get warm, which is important because the final case where I will put Cerberus will be transparent plexiglass, and it will be very close to the board, so we don't want any heat source underneath. So a regulator is the way to go. I'm over-engineering everything. I'm putting a 2 ampere regulator here, even though the current consumption of Cerberus will be significantly below 1 amp. According to my little calculations, we will measure it after the board is back and populated and tested. I will measure exactly what the current consumption is. But I like to over-engineer things, so I'm putting a 2 ampere regulator there. A 1 ampere should be sufficient as well. So this is old news. Let's look at the new news. That is the main circuit, the part that has been developed on the breadboard for the past several weeks. Now remember, now we have spacer, which is the control nexus of the whole architecture. It is also an ATF1508 CPLD, 5 volts. I'm using the same mechanism that you can see here to get the CPLD to have proper power on reset. The same strategy, I'm taking the spacer buffer enable from a pin in spacer. Let me find where that pin is here. It's pin 25, spacer buffer enable. That goes into the base of Q3. When spacer is powered on, this is high, the transistor is closed, and then this point here will be low, and therefore the buffer that passes on the main clock here in pin 2 to spacer in the form of the boosted main clock in pin 18 here, that will be enabled, and only then spacer will get its clock after the power on is complete. And while it's powering on, this point here will be high, and therefore spacer reset connected to pin 1 in there will be high, so spacer will be in a reset mode during power on. And after the power on is complete and SPBE goes high and the transistor closes, this will be low and spacer will come out of reset mode. This is the same thing you've seen before. I'm also using a buffer. The main job of the buffer is to isolate spacer from the clock signal during power up, but I'm also using it to achieve, for instance, electrical decoupling between the sound signal that comes from CAT or the Atmega 328. It comes out from CAT here in pin 6. I'm electrically decoupling it from the buzzer, which you don't see on this page, it is in the next page. I'm decoupling it, bypassing it through the buffer, and out comes the buffer sound signal, and that's the one that goes to the buffer. And I'm also boosting all the clock signals, the main clock, the CAT clock, the 6502 clock, and the Z80 clock. All these signals are passed through the buffer to make sure that they have sufficient drive to go across the board if needed, and make sure that nobody misses a tick, literally, nobody misses a tick of the clock. Now, the other connections are all implemented through labels. I'm not using bus markings, I find them confusing. But the architecture is quite simple. Ignore the control signals for now. All these devices, except for CAT, which is a serial controller, all the other devices get the address bus and the data bus. Some of them don't get all the bits of the address bus because that's not needed. For instance, the low and the high memory are 32 kilobyte devices, so they don't need 16 bits, they only need 15. So they get address lines from 0 to 14, and they don't need address line 15. The CPUs need everything, They need all 16 address lines and all 8 data lines, so they get everything. And spacer also gets everything because spacer has the memory management logic in it, so it needs all the bits of the address bus. And CAT communicates to the buses via spacer, as we've discussed before. So that's basically it. And as for the control part, there is no bus. A spacer is a sort of a fully connected control nexus. All control signals, for instance, read-write bit for the 6502, the bus enable for the 6502, the read signal for the Z80, the memory request signal of the Z80, the bus request of the Z80, and the associated CAT signals, which are these that you see in here, CPU select, CPU interrupt request, CPU go, and CPU reset, they all go in and out of spacer, so there is no need for a bus. This is better than a bus. We have a fully connected control nexus, so this is what you see with these other signals here, wired into spacer, mainly on the right-hand side. Here, there are a few on the left-hand side as well that you see there. Now, there are lots of decoupling and bypass capacitors. I'm being very liberal in my use of bypass. This is recommended in the datasheet, for instance, of the dual-ported memories, but I'm really going overboard and total over-engineering here, since this is a didactic platform. I thought, you know, I'll really go for it. Another thing I'm doing, I'm using separate JTAG ports for each of the CPLDs. You know, I could use just a JTAG chain and use only one port, but then I would have to route those signals globally all around the board, which I don't like. And then I also think it's less didactic. It's, you know, it's clearer when you are plugging your JTAG cable right next to the device you want to reconfigure. So I'm using 3 JTAG ports. So 2 for the video circuit that you saw before. So one is in here for Skunk, another one for Caviar over there, and then a third one here for spacer. And now let's go to the final page, which is the periphery circuitry. These are very simple. So the first row that you see here on top, these are just pull-down resistors for the data bus, from data bit 0 all the way to data bit 7. Now, we need the buses to always be defined, even if no device is driving the buses. In the datasheet of the dual-ported memories, they say very clearly that you have to pull both the data and the address buses up or down. Which one to do? Is it up? Is it down? It doesn't matter much for CMOS devices. For TTL devices, you want to pull up, because it's easier to go against a pull-up resistor if you want the signal to be low. It's easier to go against the pull-up resistor by grounding the signal. The current demand on the TTL devices is a lot lower than if you would have to go against a pull-down resistor. The current demand would be higher. So with TTL in general, I'm not sure it's applicable in every case, but in general, you would rather pull the buses up as opposed to pull them down in order to define the buses, even if nobody's driving them. But for CMOS, things are more symmetric. It doesn't matter much, therefore, so I find it more intuitive to pull the buses down. In other words, the default value of the buses is 0, not 1. The address 0 or opcode 0. There are some situations in which you might think it's better to pull them up, like if the opcode for a no op is 11111, you might want to pull things up so the processor would fetch a no op in case nobody's driving. But yeah, this situation, this is a very theoretical situation. It will not happen in Cerberus. So I pulled both the buses down. The second line here is just the pull down resistors for all 16 bits of the address bus. Now, for the control signals, it's a different story. For the control signals, you have to pull up or down depending on what the default value or the non-active value of the control signal it should be. And the control signals are all, in Cerberus, they're all active low. So we don't want them active by default. So we use pull-ups for all of them. So these are the memory control signals that you see here on the third line. There are... This is, you see, 9, 10, 11. There are 11 pull-ups for the memory control signals, which go from chip enable to write enable to read-write, output enable, and the busy flags of the two dual-ported memories. So they are all pulled up. In the case of the busy flags, instead of being pulled up by a normal 10k ohm resistor, I'm pulling them up with a 270 ohm resistor, and the data sheet of the memories, of the dual ported memories that I'm using, tell you to pull them up with this resistor value. So there are electrical considerations in the inner circuitry of these memories that require you to do so. By the way, there is another reason you want to define the buses by pulling the buses up or down, and that is some of these devices have internal pull-ups or pull-downs. And if you let the buses float under any circumstance, you may trigger both the pull-up and the pull-down internal resistor of a device hanging from the bus, which can lead to huge current draw. You're basically creating a short circuit within the device. So we don't want that. It's another reason to use pull-ups or pull-downs. There is a story in the BBC Micro in 1981. The first prototype they had didn't have pull-ups or pull-downs in the data bus. And I heard this from an interview Steve Ferber gave, the designer. And he said the thing would only work if you would put your finger on those traces related to the data bus, and they solved that by putting a resistor network that if I remember correctly, by looking at the board, I think it pulls the data bus down, and that finally solved that stability problem. So there is historical evidence that we should keep the buses always defined, even if it costs more resistors. Resistors are very cheap anyway. Now, so these are the control signals for the memories that you see on the third line. And then in the last two lines here, we have the control signals for the two processors. There is only one control signal that we need to terminate. That's the read-write signal from GAT. So we pull that one up. We are pulling them all up with 10k resistors, which is the sort of the default pull-up value. Some people prefer 3.3k. I myself have used 3.3k. But 10k is okay. So there are these four control signals of the 6502 that we are pulling up: the read-write, the bus enable, the no-maskable interrupt bit, and the reset. And there are a few more, there are seven that we are pulling up for the Z80. The Z80 has more control inputs, so we are pulling these signals up. And remember, for the control signals, the reason we need to pull them up or down, in this case up because they're all active low, the reason we need to do that is that these processors will go into a tri-state mode when, for instance, CAT is active or the other processor is active. A CPU will go into a tri-state mode, and it will tri-state its control outputs as well. Some of these signals are control outputs. So we don't want, for instance, the read-write signal from the 6502 is a control output. The read, the write, and the memory request here of the Z80, they are control outputs. So when they tri-state and they go into a high impedance state, these control outputs will go into a high impedance state as well and will float. And because we are not using a bus, we are using a control nexus in spacer, we cannot allow these signals to float, because otherwise the Boolean logic equations within spacer will have undefined inputs and therefore undefined outputs that will float as well, and the whole thing will break down. So that's why we need to pull them up as well, because we are using a control nexus and not a control bus. I've added two headers to make it easier for people to hook up their oscilloscopes or logic analyzers to the data bus and the address bus. I also wanted to, I wanted a pin header for all the control signals as well, but it made the routing challenge impossible, so I gave up on that idea. Now I'm adding a character EEPROM next to the dual-ported SRAM that plays the role of character memory. The idea is you install one or the other, never the two at the same time. But the idea is the following: if we go back to the video circuitry, to the video circuitry. So here is the character memory. What happens is that during startup, Cerberus will fetch the character definitions from an SD card and will load those definitions into the character dual-ported RAM. Because when you turn the computer on, the contents of that RAM are undefined. The computer was just off, so they need to be loaded during the bootstrap process of the computer. The problem is, if there is any problem in that bootstrap process, for instance, the file system is not working, you cannot access the SD card, then you will see nothing on the screen because there will be no stable character definitions. So that's why I decided to add an EEPROM slot. In case the user has some problems, you can always remove the dual-ported SRAM that plays the role of character memory and add a pre-programmed EEPROM instead, and then you will always have the character set in the system. That's the idea. Now the rest is the peripheral ports. So this is the buzzer. We get the buffered sound signal going into the buzzer. This is the PS2 keyboard port. We only need two signals from it, the keyboard date and the keyboard clock, and then VCC and ground, of course. And then we have five SD card adapter ports. Port 5, port 4, 3, 2, and 1. And why 5? Well, let me start by saying you can only populate one of them at a time. They are not made to be used concurrently. The reason I'm doing that is that although originally I wanted to build the SD card circuitry in the main board of Cerberus, I realized that you cannot get, for instance, a micro SD card slot through hole. You can, I found one from a small company in Belgium, a small retailer in Belgium, but none of you probably would find it. So it would be a mess to use a through-hole component for that. Very hard to find. So you would have to do SMD, and you know, SMD soldering for a small micro SD card is not easy. You need a microscope and need some skills. Also, the chips used, they are hard to find in through-hole versions. They are very easy to find in SMD versions, and I didn't want there to be any SMD soldering required for Cerberus main board. I also realized that those little SD card adapters, they are very, very easy to purchase. There are loads of versions. They are open hardware projects. So, you know, different manufacturers in China can just download them and make them. They are abundant and they are very cheap. I found some of them for $1.50. It would cost a lot more to implement the same functionality in through-hole 5-volt technologies in Cerberus, if at all possible. 5-volt wouldn't be possible anyway. I would need a regulator, a 3.3-volt regulator anyway. But it would be more expensive to do that. So I decided to settle for having the user procure a micro SD card adapter and just plugging it into Cerberus. And the analogy is, if you had a computer from the 80s, you would also buy a hard disk drive that didn't come with the computer, and you'd just plug it into the computer. So think of these ports as disk drive ports for you to connect your own disk drive, so to say. And there are five of them for the simple reason that the many SD card adapters I found in the market, they have different pinouts. And then since I had board space, I just put one port for each of the different pinouts I found. So Cerberus would be compatible with most, if not all, SD card adapters that one can find in the market. And the final thing is an FDDI adapter port in order to program CAT. So if one wants to reprogram and reconfigure CAT, there is a port on the board that allows you to connect your own little FDDI adapter. It's a small little board, usually red, and reprogram CAT at will. So that's the final board. So this pretty much is the design, the schematics, and this is the PCB design, the custom PCB design. It looks very complex. I will walk you guys through it, but before I even do that, let's generate a 2D image of Cerberus. Here it is. It's easier to explain things here. I wanted the placement of the components on the custom board to reflect in a very didactic, very obvious way, the architecture of Cerberus. So what I did is the following. I put the two dual-ported memories horizontally in the middle. And then to one side, we have the pull-down resistors of the address bus, and in the other side, the pull-down resistors of the data bus. So this divides the board in two here, horizontally. Above it, we have the video circuitry. We have Cavia, we have Skunk, we have the little buffer in between, we have the two JTAG programming ports, one for Cavia and the other one for Skunk, placed right next to the respective chip, so there is no doubt about what each port does. Here we have the oscillator for the VGA pixel clock, 25.175 megahertz. And then we have some analog circuitry here to drive the signal into the VGA port, which you see over there. So board is divided in two by the two dual-ported memories. To the upside of the dual-ported memories, we have the video circuitry, and to the bottom side of the dual-ported memories, we have the computer proper. So it's very clear what's happening here just by looking at the placement of the devices. Now, in the center of the lower part, we have spacer, which is the control nexus, the chip to which all control signals go and from which all control signals depart. So it's only fair that it should be right in the middle. It's the nexus of the whole thing. It is what ties everything together. So that's why spacer is in the middle. And then we have one CPU, the 6502 and CAT to one side, plus the second buffer. And then to the other side, we have the low and high memory and the Z80. And spacer is in the middle of this whole thing here. And around spacer, on the top side of the board, which is what you see here, going from left to right, we have the buses. So spacer is sort of the center of the star, and the control signals radiate to every side from it, and surrounding it clockwise on the top part of the board and anti-clockwise on the bottom side of the board, we have the buses, the address and control buses, the address and data buses that go to all these different components. So you see, just by looking at the board, one can immediately recover or see a reflection of the concept behind Cerberus's architecture. The dual-ported memories separating video and the main part, and spacer as the control nexus around which everything else happens, and around which the buses are also routed. Now, this is the extra character EEPROM, which can replace the character dual-ported memory to make bootstrap easier to debug. These are two of the SD card ports. They have different sizes because I'm thinking of two different micro SD card adapters here, and they both go horizontally, so they are flush, more or less flush against the board, and these allow you to connect different types of micro SD cards vertically into the board, going perpendicularly to the board. Of course, only one of these five here can be populated at any one time. I just wanted to make Cerberus flexible enough that whatever micro SD card you got your hands on, it probably will fit somewhere across this port. Now, the FTDI adapter is here, very close to CAT, because it's used to reprogram CAT. And then we have a 16 megahertz clock as the main clock, at a different frequency than the video circuit, and what allows us to have completely asynchronous clocks, different than asynchronous clocks, are the dual-ported memories. So here on the top we have one clock domain governed by this oscillator, and on the bottom we have a completely asynchronous different clock domain governed by this main clock here, this main oscillator of 16 megahertz. And this is just the JTAG programming port for spacer. Now, the pull-up and pull-down resistors for the control signals, for the address bus they are here, for the data bus they are here, for the control signals they are distributed around. Most of them are here. There are a few of them here, there is one in between the two memories, there are two of them down here, another two down there, there is one here to the right, which is the right neighbor of the low memory, a couple more over there. And I wanted to put them side by side as well and put a pin header so they could be easily read with a logic analyzer, but the routing was impossible. And the reason is the following. Look, I'm trying to achieve multiple goals with this placement and this routing. One of them is what I just discussed, to allow people to just look at it and see what's going on. I also wanted to have all the traces visible, and that's why I'm making the traces fairly thick. The traces are, I can show you here, if I go to the main design, if I click on one of them and you see here, they are 0.35 millimeters thick, which is pretty thick. Normally they are 0.254 or something. So these are significantly thicker, and that's good electrically, there's more metal, but it also makes it easier to follow the traces. So that's a price to pay. It makes routing more difficult because you're routing, you know, thicker lines that cannot be as close together as otherwise. Another thing that made it difficult is that although I'm using four layers, I'm routing all the signals either on the top or the bottom layer. So the top layer, the signals, the traces are in red. The bottom layer, the traces are in blue. And you see they are sort of perpendicular as they should be. There should be no right angles within a single side, only 45 degree angles. So all those best practices are observed. But all the traces are, well, traceable by just looking at the board. You may have to flip it around because I do use vias. All these little things here, they are vias. So you have one trace coming up from the top. This trace in red here comes from the top and it goes through the via and comes out on the other side of the board from the bottom in blue. So you may have to flip the board around to trace things. Some of this stuff may be happening underneath the sockets, so they will not be trivial to see. But I had this rule of thumb, I wanted every trace to be visible. So I'm using the two inner layers, sandwiched inside the board, only as power and ground planes. So if I go to those layers, so this is the power layer. You see there are no traces, it's just a massive copper flood. It's a power plane. And this is the ground layer, which is a ground plane. There are no traces there. Only on the top and the bottom we see the traces. So that's also, you know, something I wanted to do in order to make this board even more didactic and more retro as well, because in the old computers, you know, there were only two layers, so you could see every trace. The same thing happens now. You can see every trace. If you're using it on a CAD tool, like I am, it's very easy to trace them. You just hover over one of the signals and you see exactly where it goes. For instance, this is the data zero bit of the data bus. And it goes from the 6502 to the video memory, down to spacer, up to the character memory, down to the low memory, high memory, and finally to the Z80. So it goes everywhere, as it should. So it's very easy to just hover over the design here with a CAD tool and you can convince yourself that you've routed everything that needed to be routed and everything is going to the right place. And it does that even across vias. For instance, this signal I'm highlighting right now, there is a via over there. So it will highlight the trace across both layers to see where the signal is actually going electrically. This is a DRC clean board. I did run the design rule check. So, for instance, if I check the design rules, DRC stands for design rule check, so check DRC is kind of a linguistic exaggeration. I'm checking the DR. And here we see we have zero DRC errors. So ultimately, I did manage to get everything placed and routed on a micro ATX format. These are the holes required by the micro ATX standard. So I managed to place and route everything in there using only two layers for the routing and using very thick traces. I made the problem extraordinarily difficult for myself because you see, spacer is a control nexus, so it's connected everywhere. This is an architecture with four memory chips and two CPUs plus a microcontroller. So there is a lot of connections here, signals that have to go everywhere. It was a challenge to route it, especially here around the pins of spacer, because spacer is such a control nexus. It was difficult to route it all. I had to use several vias even within the socket, which is not the best. PCB designers don't like to drop vias like confetti. I'm not really a PCB designer, it's not my specialization, but I can do it. People who do it are very proud when they manage to do it without a single via. And my little Sally adapter for the Atari was done without a single bloody via, although I used four layers because I had huge space constraints. I did that without any via. I did the 65 CO2 adapter for the VIC-20 and the Apple II. I did it without vias, but this was impossible. We need vias here, so I did use them. You see them everywhere. But that it was possible at all, I consider a little achievement. I'm happy with it, that it was possible at all, despite Spacer having so many memories, so many processors, so many connections because of this Nexus approach, that I still managed to do it makes me quite happy. I was not sure when I started whether I would really manage to do that in only two layers, except for power and ground planes, of course. And the last thing I wanted to mention is that although I plan to just sandwich this board in clear plexiglass casing, which I think is nicer because you can see the board, you can see the signals, more didactic. I did conform, I did make sure to conform to the micro ATX standard, so the dimensions are micro ATX and the holes required are all there. If you prefer to not see the board, you can fit it, hopefully, I would test it still, but you should be able to fit it in any standard micro ATX case that you just can buy for any PC. That's there as well. Some markings on the silkscreen identifying Cerberus. I even put the same markings on the metal layers, so they're really etched into the metal identifying Cerberus. In the silkscreen, I try to be as helpful as possible. I say, for instance, that you should populate only one SD card port at a time, so people don't make a mistake. Or over here, I say, you know, do not install a character SRAM together with the character EEPROM, it's one or the other. I try to identify all the signals, for instance, these pull-up resistors here, I identified the signals they are pulling up right next to them, you know, the right signal of the Z80, the reset of the 6502, the non-maskable interrupt of the 6502, the refresh of the Z80, the chip enable of the character memory, the read-write of the character memory, and so on and so forth. They are all identified on the silk screen. I identified the chips as well, not only with their names, like CAT, but also with the part number. So it's easy to see, you know, what each one of these devices actually is. I identified the signals of the adapters. There is only one thing I still want to do on this one, because when you connect an FTDI adapter here, you have to make sure that the transmitter or TX of the adapter plugs into the receiver or the RX of the board and the other way around. So I probably put some annotation here next to RX and TX. Alerting people that, you know, these have to be reversed when you connect them, although there would be no other way of inserting the adapter into this slot. But I will add that to the silkscreen as well, to try to be extra helpful. Now, another thing we can have a look at is the 3D view of what's happening. It's very helpful, this 3D view, because you see, you know, whether things actually fit together, whether there is space for everything, and whether it looks good as well. So this is the 3D view of the board. You see lots of these little capacitors. Most of them are just bypass capacitors for the power rail, 100 nanofarad. There are a couple of them, this one here, and this in here, down here, and this. These are filter capacitors for the boosted clock signals of the two CPUs. This one here is to reduce the pulse of the reset signal coming from the FTDI adapter to program the Atmega. And there is one more. This is for the reset signal, and then there are two filter capacitors there. I believe everything else, all these other small yellow tantalum capacitors, in fact, I will be using ceramic disc capacitors, not the tantalum ones, but the rest of them are just decoupling. There are other two filter capacitors here for the horizontal sync pulse and the vertical sync pulse. These are 470 picofarad devices for filtering. And then there is a large decoupling capacitor right next to the input power signal. This is 470 microfarads. These two here are 10 microfarads. One is just decoupling for the ports, and the other one is decoupling for the video signal. And then there are two beefier decoupling ones here next to the memories. These are 100 microfarads. As well as here, these two down here are 100 microfarads. To make sure that the CPUs, and this one is 100 microfarads as well next to spacer. So these are to make sure that the CPUs, spacer, and the large memories have clean power signals. And there are two 10 microfarad decoupling capacitor here next to the, or this one here. Yeah, next to the CPUs and the high and low memory. This is well over engineered. We certainly don't need so much decoupling and bypass power. We probably don't even need these two filter caps here and these two filter caps there. This one we do need for the for programming CAT. This one is absolutely essential. The others probably are not. But again, this is a didactic architecture. These capacitors cost nothing. So I just put them in there to illustrate the reason even why they are used. That's about it. There are three transistors in this architecture. This here, up here next to Skunk, and this one here next to Spacer are just for the to clean up the power on reset process of the large CPLDs. And this one here is just for impedance matching and extra buffering. Maybe I should explain that by going back to the diagram of the video circuitry here. That's the transistor I was talking about, Q1. Although the RGB signal that comes here from pin 5 of the first buffer, it's already buffered because it's coming out of a buffer, I'm using this extra amplifying transistor here in order to get some impedance matching. And the reason is the following. When you send an RGB signal via the VGA connector to the screen, from this point here, the impedance you will see if you look that way, so if you look from left to right from this point here, you will see the following impedance: the resistance of the trim potentiometer and 75 ohm, which is the equivalent impedance of the VGA monitor. So you'll be seeing trim pot plus 75 ohm. So what you want to happen is that from the point of view of the monitor looking into Cerberus, you want to see the same equivalent impedance to ground, the same 75 plus the resistance of the trim pot. And the reason is, if you see a different impedance looking from either side of the connection, you will get waves bouncing back at the other side. So you get reflections, and that leads to ringing in the signal, which probably will be no problem at all. That ringing, probably we can leave it there, it will not be a problem. But to do it nicely, you want to terminate this RGB signal to ground through a 75 ohm resistor R1 hanging from the emitter of an amplifying transistor, because then you will match the two impedances and you will not get the signal reflections. You will not get this ringing. So that's basically the reason for this extra transistor here, to allow me to do this termination of the signal via a 75 ohm resistor. And then you get a cleaner signal. It plays a role similar to these two filter caps here for 470 picofarads. I thought, you know, for the synchronization pulses which happen now and then, these capacitors would be okay, but for the RGB signal which is oscillating all the time, I would do proper signal termination. That's the reason for that, and that's why in the 3D view you see this extra transistor here, Q1. It's doing impedance matching through this resistor, which is 75 ohm. So that's basically it. That's how the board looks like in 3D. If we move it to the other side, you see that I have silkscreen markings on that side as well, over here. Same silkscreen markings. Also in the metal, I put some markings there on the metal as well, just for good measure. But this is how it will look like. And the ports are just these standard slots here. You can insert the pins vertically here, vertically on these two as well, although for these two I assume that the adapter will be horizontal and flush against the board, And for these three, they will be vertically inserted perpendicular to the board itself, just like the FTDI adapter, which will also be inserted vertically perpendicular to the board. So this is it for this episode. The next step is, as soon as I finish this video, I'm going to send this board to the manufacturers after I make a correction to the silkscreen here, like I just said a few minutes ago. And then in 1.5 weeks it should be back. I will populate it, test it, and I will make a video reporting on the results of that test. So I hope you found this video instructive in some way. Maybe it encourages you to make custom PCBs for your own projects. It's fairly easy. Well, don't start with something as complex as Cerberus, but it is actually not difficult to make a PCB. You don't really need to be a PCB designer to design out circuits up to 10 megahertz frequency. Well, this one runs at 25 here on top, but you know, up to 10 megahertz, you don't really need, you know, specialist knowledge of how to design these circuits. For this one, we needed a little bit, you know, mostly using power and ground planes and for extra bypass, because the power and ground planes work as a sort of a huge capacitor spread across the board. Not only that, they help you stop crosstalk between signals. Now we put the signals perpendicular to each other across the layers in order to reduce crosstalk. So I kept doing that because it's just good practice, but with the two inner planes, the ground and VCC plane in the middle, you have electrical isolation between the top and bottom layer. So it makes things easier, and this is required by these two dual ported memories, required by the high speed part here on top. But if you don't do this complex stuff, if you use, you know, standard 74 logic and maybe one CPU and two regular SRAM chips, you really don't need to know much about PCB design. The tools guide you through, and you can do that yourself easily as a hobbyist or as a student. So I hope this has encouraged you to do that. And I will be back next time reporting on whether this board has succeeded or whether I will have to do another pass. So take care until then, and I will see you then. Bye-bye.